this.
Channeling comes from an idea that I had when I was shooting a documentary up in San Francisco, California. And the idea just came to me that what if people could broadcast their lives from their point of views as much or as little as they wanted to? And then what would be the repercussions of living your life with other people, with an audience watching from your point of view what you do? And I thought of the idea and then immediately started thinking, well, you know, what happens if you have, you know, if you need to maintain an audience? If now you are living a life that requires you to be entertaining in the way you live, so would that mean that people would start creating dramas out of their own lives, fictional dramas, except for in the real world with real consequences? And that led to sponsorship, and the idea that, you know, what happens if, how would it change my behavior and my choices if now it is my job to live a dramatic life? So I came up with the idea and initially was shopping it around as a television show. I thought of it, I mean, I thought the concept itself seemed broad enough that that it could sustain a longer narrative, multi-episodes, and that would give us opportunity to tell stories of people in different parts of the world and broadcasting, because of course the internet is not does not have borders, at least not yet. And so I initially wrote it as a 47-page pilot script. And then spent probably a year and a half to 2 years of writing it and shopping it as a TV pilot. Then I ended up getting a couple offers, one to develop it as a TV series, one was to develop it as a movie and rewriting the script. I spent the next year and a half rewriting it as a screenplay, which I found extremely difficult. But I did rewrite it eventually and ended up with something like a 110-page script. The structure of the movie is a little bit unusual honestly a little bit rough, because there's two stories. There's the A story, which is the story of Jonah. He's back on bereavement leave to go to his brother's funeral, and he comes home believing his brother was just in a terrible accident. And the police really blame his brother's death on the brother, because the brother was on drugs and he was involved in theft. And so to the police, it's sort of a who cares. And then there's the story of his sister, who has a fledgling channel where she is trying to talk about fashion and just do what a lot of young women who are going to do this would, how the kind of stories they would want to tell. And she ends up being exploited by her boyfriend. This type of narrative did absolutely come out of the fact that it was written as a TV series. And it was intended to have different characters and different storylines to sustain the length of a television season. So though I'm not proud to admit it, some of that structure remained into the feature film. If I had to choose which story to tell, I absolutely would have told the story of Jonah and his brother. I decided early on to structure this like a film noir, Asphalt Jungle or Ififi or any of the film noirs that I love. And a lot of these stories, a lot of movies that I like, including film noir and including biker films, are told about people returning from war, characters, and you end up with a narrator, a protagonist, who you are unsure of their mental condition because of the traumas that they have been subjected to. Of course, I do feel as though a lot of this could be clearer in channeling, but I'm gratified to hear that you noticed that Jonah slowly sort of tries to become his brother. And in English, channeling is a double meaning, like television channels, or else channeling somebody else. You know, this concept that you could you could go to karaoke and you could be channeling your favorite rock star. So sort of you use yourself to bring that person into being where you are right now. Mm-hmm. And so Jonah was more and more attempting to channel his brother in order to serve a purpose, but ideally that purpose should be personal as well as just sort of to further the plot. He needs to channel his brother. He needs the audience to believe that he is his brother in order to draw out the conspirators who murdered his brother. I absolutely, and you know, Paul Walker, who passed away recently, as I'm sure your audience knows, he even said that he really prefers the real street racing with real cars and things that can actually physically happen, as opposed to cars jumping out of the backs of planes and such. That's not for me. I understand the need for a big spectacle, but that's less interesting to me than real street races. And I years ago shot a documentary on a part of a series called Country's Most Shocking in the United States, where I was actually with real street racers and with undercover police that were chasing those street racers. So I've been in real street races, and I really tried to do things, even though there was some stuff that is extreme that's happening in channeling. I tried to create things that really do happen. I mean, we really do have biker gangs in California and, well, the rest of the United States, especially the West. We really do, when I wrote the scene where, at the beginning of Car Chase, where Wyatt's stolen car tears the arm off a gas pump, that had happened to one of my friends who I was talking to while I was writing the script. He had accidentally done that. It didn't go very far, but it did happen. He did tear the arm off a gas pump and leave gas all over the place. But to me, even though digital video effects can be very good and can be very realistic, the second you know that you're looking at something that is an effect, it's failed in its mission. If you don't know you're seeing an effect, and you just think you're seeing is really what you're seeing really happened in front of a camera, then that effect is succeeding. The second you say, "Oh, that's a really great digital effect," well, that effect is a failure. Of course, I wouldn't have had the budget to do big digital effects, but even if I had, I would greatly prefer to do everything practically, everything physically, while still maintaining safety. That was my biggest concern. I mean, the opening car chase has a Mustang fastback, a Shelby Mustang fastback, dragging a gasoline hose down a country road almost. It's a mountain road, really. Well, we had luckily just had a lot of rain, but as your audience knows, it's very dry in California. And so we were very worried about setting fire to to a city park. And my producer said to me, only half jokingly, as we went off to shoot this scene, he said, "Please don't set fire to the city park." Which now I don't even know if they would allow us to do it because it's been so dry. We're in a drought. But the chase scenes were very tough. We were restricted as to the hours we could film the chase with the Firebird. All the dialogue in the car and all the chase scene outside of the car with the multiple, all those cars in that intersection that are chasing, all the police cars, everything, those are cars that we rented with professional drivers. And we shot that whole, both scenes, inside the car and outside the car. Well, I guess it's one scene. That was all done in 6 hours. We had to be done at 3 p.m. I think we asked the police if we could have an extra 10 minutes to do one more take, and that was it. So a very, very strict restrictions, and there is, when I see the scene, I'm okay with the way it turned out, what I see is stuff that I wish we could have had time to do. I wanted that chase scene to be longer and more involved and more dangerous, but this is independent cinema. When I first started pitching the concept of channeling, I got a very good response. I was blessed to have a lot of good meetings about it and such. The one criticism I got was that it was, quote, too much, it was too sci-fi. It was too distant future. And A, I didn't agree with that at all, and I think time has proven that that it's not at all too sci-fi. I think it's very soon that this could happen. When I was writing it, there was no Google Glass. There was no Oculus Rift. There was no, well, Google just applied for a patent for an actual contact lens camera. That just happened about a month ago. Obviously, I started this process 4 years ago. So I think I really worked very hard to make the technology as mundane as possible. I wanted everything to feel like it could be 6 months from now, not 20 years from now. And I did that, A, because I was resisting this criticism of being too science fiction, but also because I think that channeling is intended to be a bit of a cautionary tale about the dangers of where this technology could go. You know, if people are walking around trying to make themselves into movie heroes, but with real life consequences. And I also, I mean, you know, it really wasn't and is intended to be about our need for approval from others, external approval, as opposed to being able to find that within ourselves. And I am as guilty as anyone. I was very resistant to the criticism of it being too sci-fi, but I really endeavored to make everything as familiar, if you will, as possible from the user interface at the bottom. We just copied the user interfaces of existing cell phone applications. Not only because I want it to be a sci-fi movie, but I didn't want it to be a distant future sci-fi movie, but also because I think that if your movie feels like it's the distant future, or even, you know, the not so distant, even if it feels like 20 years from now, I think it gives the audience a little objective distance. They're all there to say, oh, well, that may or may not ever happen. This I wanted to feel like, yeah, this is crazy as this is, this is where we're going. And so I didn't want to let the audience have the distance from the idea and from the story that I think sometimes we have from sci-fi. You know, it's very easy to watch Minority Report and think the concepts are interesting, but feel like, okay, well, you know, who knows if there'll ever be, you know, police for future crimes, or that may or may not, it could happen. So again, I wanted it to be very familiar, very much immediate. As far as the technology goes, I didn't know if a contact lens camera was actually possible, though I spoke to an engineer while I was deeply, pretty far into the writing process. I spoke to an engineer, and he told me that CCDs are being developed that are tiny enough so that that they could fit between two membranes in a contact lens, and that it would actually work.